Almost all quantitative models of human spread are based on Fisher's equation. Fisher's equation describes the population change per unit time. Here I use F for farmers, but it need not be farmers. We can deal with hunter-gatherer. In fact, Fisher's equation has been applied many times to the out-of-Africa expansion. But I here have written farmers for later discussion. So in this equation, this change is explained as a result of two processes: the process of diffusion and the process of reproduction. The reproduction is described by a logistic, and this has been very well explained by Lisa, so it is now clear. And the diffusion term is driven by the diffusion coefficient, in this case of farmers, that could be hunter-gatherers. And here we have this triangle, which is a Laplacian, but this is not necessary because we shall see later that the better and more precise model does not need this symbol. So the important fact is that when this equation is used to describe a human rate expansion, then the speed of this expansion, the speed of the wave of advance of the population, is given by Fisher's equation. So the faster the reproduction, the higher the value of A, the initial growth rate, and the faster the range expansion. And similarly, the farther away humans move per generation, then the greater the diffusion coefficient and the faster the expansion. This is very reasonable, but in fact, there is an important fact that is not very well known, and is the following. Fisher's equation is only an approximation. It's not an exact result. It's an approximation that can be obtained from this equation, which in fact is much simpler. Because here we have the population, the density of the population change, the difference between time t and time t plus capital T, where capital T is one generation, and this change in the population density is again due to two processes. The process in red, which we now call dispersal, and the process in blue, which is net reproduction, and it's also driven by a logistic. So the difference between this model and Fisher's model is in the red term. This term, the dispersal term here, is very simple to understand because these integrals are only sums. So what we are doing is simply adding up the contributions of the humans that arrive from different places. In other words, in order to see how the population changes at position xy, we consider all possible origins for the movement of humans from a position which is a distance delta x and delta y. And we multiply this initial density by the probability that humans move a distance delta x delta y. So all we are doing here is to add up the contribution of the humans that arrive from different distances and to subtract the humans who live. So this is much easier to understand, the Fisher's equation. There is not a question here, and it is also much more precise. This is well established, this is reasonable, but Fisher's equation is only an approximation that is obtained from this equation if we consider that the distances, delta x, delta y, and moved and the generation time are small enough. But is this a good approximation, or does, in other words, can Fisher's equation be applied to humans or not? Well, we can answer this question if we compute the speed from this equation and we compare the result to Fisher's speed. In order to do so, we consider here five pre-industrial populations and their dispersal probabilities. This means, for example, that 54% of this population move a distance of about 2.4 km and so on. We don't have the whole distances because in ethnographic work, what is reported are the histograms. They group the distances in some internals. But using these ethnographic real values for the industrial farmers, and using also ethnographic, so realistic values for the initial growth rate and the generation time, we can find the speed from this precise equation and compare it to Fisher for each of these five populations. And here we find that Fisher gives a larger, as much as 50%. So if we want to compare a model to the data, the political data, we cannot use Fisher equation. We can use it if we want to compare the order of magnitude, but not the precise value of the speed. And this is just another improvement that has been proposed to this equation. This is the same equation as in the previous slide, and it is usually called non-cohabitation equation. In contrast, this equation, which is also used very often in the ecological literature, is called the cohabitation equation. What is the difference? Simply that here we add up the effect of dispersal, which is shown in red, and plus the effect of net reproduction, which is shown in blue. In contrast, in the commutation equation, we first apply, for example, the reproduction, and then we apply the dispersal to the resulting population. We could do it the other way around, to apply first the dispersal and the reproduction, but the speed is the same. So the important fact is that this model has a different speed than this one. And how can we see that this model is better than this one? Well, a very simple way to see this is to consider a very simple example in which all of the humans are initially at this location, and half of them move to this place, and the other half to this place. Then, the non-commutation equation, and therefore Fisher's equation, because it comes from this one, it's an approximation of this one, predict that in the original location, some people appear. The new generation appears at the place where the parents are no longer with you. And this is not reasonable. Why does this new generation appear here? Because the reproduction term takes place at xy, which is the same place of, where we are computing the population density. In contrast with the commutation equation, first the population reproduces and then all of it moves. So here there is no longer people, and this is much more reasonable. So if we want to know what is the error of using or not using this commutation effect, we find that this is about 30%, and again, Fisher's equation compared to this still better model based on the commutation effect also gives an error of about 30%. Finally, there is another very simple way to see the Fisher's equation cannot be valid in general is this one. If the reproduction rate becomes very, very large, Fisher's speed becomes very, very large. It increases without any bound. In contrast, the commutation speed is bounded. It cannot be larger than the maximum dispersal distance divided by the generation time, which is the result that we expect intuitively. So definitely, it is better and more reasonable to use the commutation equation than the non-commutation one, and still much better than the Fisher's equation. This is just an example that we have published last year, and this is the spread of the Neolithic, sorry, but this is my favorite case study because there are many data. But I also find the out of Africa dispersal very interesting. But unfortunately, there is not so much data still, but in the future, hopefully, this will change. So, what do we see in this case? Here we apply the computation equation to simulations. These isochrons are the arrival times of the simulated frog at different places, starting from here. The black diamonds mean that in these sites, which are the earliest regional sites for the Neolithic, the simulated front arrives too late. So if there is no sea travel, if there is only inland travel, the arrival is too late everywhere. And here we have three models with sea travel. In all of them, the sea travel can take place up to 350 kilometers because lower distances are not enough to explain the observed pattern. In this case, there is preference for propulsive destination, which is more likely that, which means that it is more likely for humans to jump short distances. But still, it arrives late almost everywhere. Here, all distances are equally likely, and so it is a little bit faster, and here all jumps are of 350 kilometers. And only in this case, the front arrives in time everywhere. So, in this work, what we concluded is that for sure, there was sea travel of at least 350 kilometers. And then, this is just to mention that this is the same equation as before, but here we add cultural transmission. This F is the only difference. This is the cultural transmission effect. I am sorry for putting so much equations. In fact, I could explain this slide without equations, just with a simulation and a bit of notes saying that the population jumps, every generation reproduces, and there is cultural transmission, which is this term, according to cultural transmission theory, which means that some hunter-gatherers learn farming from farmers. But with your permission, I have included it just to keep consistency with the previous slide. But the questions are not important. What is important is just to know that if there is cultural transmission, if some hunter-gatherers learn farming and become farmers, then the spread is faster. For C or F0, there is no cultural transmission, and we have a purely dynamic model. The higher the value of C, the more hunter-gatherers become farmers per generation, and the spread is faster. So these are the theoretical speeds, and how do they compare to the data? Archaeological data imply, if you use a database of about 1,000 early Neolithic sites in Europe, that the spread rate was between 0.9 and 1.3 kilometers per year. So this is the observed range, this blue rectangle. What does this mean? That these speeds are too fast, to be consistent with archaeology. So archaeology says that at most she was about three. It cannot be more than three because then there would be too many hunter-gatherers becoming farmers and the spread rate would be faster than the observed one. So less than three, the interpretation of this is that less than three hunter-gatherers were converted by each farmer per generation. And finally, this is the last slide, here we have the effect, which is the cultural contribution to the speed. It's the total speed minus the speed without the cultural transmission divided by the total speed by 100. And here we have the same two words as before. We have seen that archaeology says that this region is not possible because it would be too fast. But comparing to a Neolithic line of mitochondria out of UK, we have that this model predicts the shape of the line. That it predicts that the farther away from the Near East, the lower the Neolithic gene marker frequency. And in order for the simulated line to be with the observed genetic line, we have to consider on a value of C which is much smaller, about 0.2, which means that only 2% of farmers took place in cultural transmission. So according to these results, damage diffusion was more important than cultural diffusion in the spectrum of the Neolithic, and this, with this I finish this presentation of correlation models. Thank you.